This is John with your roundup for Wednesday on BBC Radio Sussex. A Sussex family are calling for a fresh inquest into how their loved one died on 9/11 20 years ago. Geoff Campbell perished when the two hijacked planes were flown into the Twin Towers in New York. Despite official reports categorically stating otherwise, his brother Matt believes it was a controlled demolition explosive, not the planes that brought the building down. He says a new inquest is needed to challenge official accounts.
You're never really going to get to know the entire truth about 9/11, but I do hope that this action through the inquest will start to open people's eyes that, you know, things aren't as simple as they've been explained to people.
Breakfast with Alice and Ferns. BBC
Radio Sussex. Yeah, can you believe it? This year sees 20 years since the 9/11 terror attacks.
This just in, that is the World Trade Center. Apparently a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center in New York.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
That looks like a second plane.
That just exploded.
God, it still makes me shiver when you hear that audio, because I think all of us probably remember where we were when that happened. In fact, you can let me know your memories of that fateful day this morning. You can text 81333, start your message with the word radio. Today, we're going to be hearing how one Sussex family who lost a loved one on 9/11 are still seeking answers.
You're never really going to get to know the entire truth about 9/11, but I do hope that this action through the inquest will start to open people's eyes that, you know, things aren't as simple as they've been explained to people.
Well, that's Matt Campbell from Hurst Pier Point, who I went to meet a couple of weeks ago. His brother, Geoff, died in the September 11th attacks on the World Trade Center in New York back in 2001. 31-year-old Geoff perished in the North Tower, leaving behind a devastated fiancé in America and a grieving family in Sussex. But they have never accepted official accounts of the disaster. They believe controlled explosives and not aircraft brought the building down.
Only one tower is standing. The other has collapsed.
We can see a billowing smoke rising. I'll tell you that I can't see that second tower.
The building has collapsed.
Big bang. And then we saw smoke coming out and everybody started running out. And we saw the plane on the other side of the building. And there was smoke everywhere. And people are jumping out the windows. Over there, they're jumping out the windows.
And covered by soot and ash. So it looks almost like snow. So as people are coming up the street, running from the scene of this new explosion.
And 20 years on, it's still so difficult to listen to. Well, now Matt and his family want the Attorney General to order a new inquest into Geoff's death in the hope that they will finally get the truth about what happened. Well, I've been to Hurst Pier Point, as I say, to speak to Matt Campbell, and he began our conversation by recalling that fateful day when he heard the news whilst on holiday in Lanzarote.
We were in this hotel, which had, like, you know, the really sort of poor quality cable TV. I think we just had one news channel that was in English, and you know, it was hard to find out what was going on. Obviously, there's lots of frantic phone calls, both with my brother and my dad and Caroline. And it wasn't really until we got back to the UK on Thursday, so 2 days later, did we kind of get more of the BBC style news and obviously papers and stuff. So we were kind of spared. We didn't really see the endless repeated loops of the plane going into, well, I think one that was televised the first day.
Caroline, the stuff I've read suggests that she kind of started searching hospitals and what have you.
We went out there about 5 days after, and I think she'd been calling or going around to hospitals. We did the same. So when we arrived, I think on the Saturday, the very next day in the morning, we called hospitals, and I remember going down to one hospital, and at that point it was, you know, very clear that he wasn't sitting in a hospital somewhere, you know, in a coma or something. She had obviously spent time. She put a lot of the missing persons posters that, you know, I think everyone remembers sort of seeing these huge walls just filled with, you know, desperate relatives, you know, saying, have you seen this person, and, you know, photo, giving all their details, where they were, etc.
And now as a family you're asking the Attorney General to reopen the inquest. Why?
For me, the circumstances surrounding my brother's death, there's lots of things that don't sit right. I've been frustrated over the years, and, you know, particularly the last decade, trying to get some sort of straight answers and even just fundamental evidence from the authorities, whether it be through freedom of information requests or contact with the FBI, counter-terrorism in the UK, the Met, etc. It's fairly obvious if you actually look at how the towers came down, and there's a great video by David Chandler called The North Tower Exploding. The tower is being demolished in front of your eyes, and a lot of people who reported on it that day spoke in those ways. They thought it was bombs, they thought the towers had been destroyed.
So you think there were explosives in the buildings?
Yes. I mean, it's not too far-fetched. There was an attempt in 1993 to bring down the towers. Ramzi Youssef was imprisoned for his role as being the chief architect. He's the nephew of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, who's in Guantanamo Bay, accused of being the chief architect. It's always been their intention to bring down those towers. And I'm not saying it was them, but I said, you know, the evidence that's there, this is, you've got explosives, residues in the dust. You've got numerous, I mean, I think it's over 150 eyewitnesses, first responders, who are reporting explosions, bombs, etc., all of which was ignored by the authorities when they did their report.
The way I understood it, the towers fell, according to official reports, because the girders melted because of the aviation fuel.
They certainly didn't melt because of the fires. They can be weakened through fire, but they can't reach temperatures high enough to actually melt the steel. But NIST, which is the body that were tasked with investigating the collapse of the towers, didn't actually go as far as explaining how the towers came down. The reports that have been put forward to me, they were trying to fit it and frame it around a certain narrative. They never once investigated or looked into the fact that, you know, explosives could have been used. Mm. There's an organisation called Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. It's over 3,000 qualified people who have, you know, looked at the evidence, and they know that, you know, towers aren't supposed to come down like they did through to fire. There's a study on the third tower that came down that day, Building 7, by the University of Alaska Fairbanks. There's a four-year study that categorically proves that that building, which again the authorities said came down because of fire, couldn't possibly have come down by fire. It actually fell at free full acceleration for 2.25 seconds. You can't do that unless there's zero structural support. The only way that happens is through the use of explosives.
It obviously sounds, Matt, like you've done extensive research over the past 20 years, but do you worry that some people will dismiss what you say and sort of just say, oh, we've heard all these conspiracy theories before?
Say that to the families of Bloody Sunday, say that to the families of Hillsborough. It's always the family members that dig the deepest and have to fight to get some sort of justice.
If there has been a cover-up, it would be a cover-up on a mass scale. Is it feasible to think that that many people could keep that secret?
There's definitely an ongoing cover-up in all aspects of 9/11. My father's involved in a lawsuit against Saudi Arabia and their state-sponsored support of 9/11. I'm still struggling to get hold of 16,000 pages to do with an investigation into Saudi involvement, again being withheld by the FBI. It's incredibly hard, and that's why, for me, the only way to put the people who just say it's a conspiracy theory, etc., to rest is to actually get this stuff in court.
And that must be incredibly hard. To lose your brother under any circumstances is a tragedy, particularly, as you say, he was so young, he had his whole life ahead of him. But to almost then have to live for the past 20 years with these unanswered questions, has that added to your grief?
Yeah, I mean, I was, you know, very depressed for about a decade, and, you know, and frustration. It's kind of like, you know, if it's such a done and dusted deal, why am I still struggling to get hold of, you know, what should be really, you know, publicly available evidence? You're never really going to get to know the entire truth about 9/11, but I do hope that this action through the inquest will start to open people's eyes that, you know, things aren't as simple as they've been explained to people.
What would you like to happen now?
Well, I'd like the Attorney General to grant his authority to push the application up to the High Court, and then for the High Court to quash my brother's initial inquest and to open and to instruct a coroner's court to have a fresh inquest and to look at the, you know, vast evidence that we've assembled that was never considered at my brother's first inquest, and obviously ultimately to change the verdict. The big question is it in the interests of justice? Well, yeah, I think so. A lot of wars were fought off the back of that, and still you know, there's still military presence. For me, yeah, my brother deserved justice. I don't know, I'd hope he'd be proud of what I've been trying to do.
I think that's the thing as well, to lose somebody you love in such a public way. And of course, now with the 20th anniversary year, you know, it's going to be everywhere, which is going to be really tough for you and your family.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's always going to be, I guess, a big year. And I think also with the inquest, it's probably, there's more interest than, you know, which is, it's no bad thing.
Have you come up against criticism? I mean, have people kind of dismissed you as some crazy conspiracy theorist?
Oh, yeah, sure. I had lots of angry discussions in pubs with certain people who, you know, just refused to look at, you know, certain bits of evidence. I'm just saying, well, go and have a look, you know. I don't have sort of that anger anymore. I tend to just walk away if, you know, the discussions get a bit heated. The more you look, the more things don't make sense.
Well, that was Matt Campbell from Hurst Pier Point talking to me about the tragic loss of his brother, who perished in the 9/11 Twin Towers attacks 20 years ago. Now, it's important to stress that those views expressed in Matt's interview are his views. There have been many questions raised about 9/11, but it's important to point out that the official US government reports have categorically stated that it was fires that caused the World Trade Center to collapse and not controlled explosives, as the Campbell family believe. The NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology in America, carried out a 3-year comprehensive building and fire safety investigation in 2002, issuing their findings in a final report published in October 2005. This is what their lead technical investigator, Shyam Sunder, said in that report.
World Trade Center 7 collapsed because of fires. In fact, we have shown for the first time that fire can induce a progressive collapse.
NIST used detailed data describing the building and its contents to create the most complex computer simulation of a structure collapse ever made. Falling debris from Tower 1 started fires on 10 floors in Building 7. A break in the city water main from the collapse of the towers disabled sprinklers in the lower half of WTC 7, allowing fires on those floors to burn for 7 hours. The NIST computer model was validated with evidence from videos, photos, witness accounts, and other data. It shows that heat from fires expanded long support beams, causing connections and floors to fail.
So you look at the floors failing here, and eventually this column 79 is going to buckle, it fails, and then the entire vertical progression takes place.
The buckled column caused additional collapsed floors and falling debris that removed support from adjacent interior columns. A chain reaction then caused other interior columns to fail in quick succession. The outside shell of the building fell. The NIST team found no evidence that explosives were involved in the collapse.
And our analysis showed that even the smallest explosive charge that was capable of bringing down the critical column in the building, had it occurred, we would have seen sound levels of 120 to 130 decibels about a half a mile away. That would have been an incredibly loud sound, and that sound was not picked up by any of the videos or witnesses that we have talked to.
Well, after 8 o'clock, I'll be speaking to Ian Henshall from Hove, who runs the Reinvestigate 9/11 campaign group in the UK and who has written extensively about the Twin Towers attack. He'll tell us more about the evidence he thinks supports the Campbells' claims.
Breakfast with Alice and Ferns.
BBC Radio Sussex.
8 minutes past eight, and as I was saying, our top story, the Sussex family, who say official accounts of the 9/11 terror attacks, in their mind, simply don't add up.
The reports that have been put forward, they were trying to fit it and frame it around a certain narrative. They never once investigated or looked into the fact that, you know, explosives could have been used.
Yeah, that's Matt Campbell from Hurst Pier Point. He tragically lost his brother Geoff in the September 11th Twin Tower attacks in New York. The 31-year-old was trapped on the 106th floor of the North Tower when hijacked aircraft were flown into the building.
This just in, that is the World Trade Center. Apparently a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center in New York.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
That looks like a second plane.
That just exploded.
Oh, just listening to that. archive audio just brings you back to where you were, doesn't it, on that fateful day. In fact, you can tell me where you were when you watched that happen. Text 81333, start your message with the word radio. Now, as we know, the official account is that the Twin Towers were brought down by raging fires caused by leaking jet fuel, which melted the supporting metal girders. But the Campbells believe they have a dossier of evidence that shows it was in fact controlled explosives and not aircraft that brought those buildings down. Well, we will hear more from Matt shortly, but I do want to stress that this is their opinion. This isn't about us giving weight to conspiracy theories. This is more about us hearing the story of a family who have in their mind unanswered questions about the death of a loved one. Now, the American National Institute of Standards and Technology carried out a 3-year comprehensive building and fire safety investigation in 2002. They issued their findings in a final report published in October 2005. This is what their lead technical investigator, Shyam Sunder, said in that report.
The NIST team found no evidence that explosives were involved in the collapse.
And our analysis showed that even the smallest explosive charge that was capable of bringing down the critical column in the building, had it occurred, we would have seen sound levels of 120 to 130 decibels about a half a mile away. That would have been an incredibly loud sound, and that sound was not picked up by any of the videos or witnesses that we have talked to.
Well, in a moment, I'll be speaking to Ian Henshall from Hove, who runs Reinvestigate 9/11, a campaign group set up to challenge the official version of what happened. But first, let's hear more from Matt Campbell. He talked to me about his memories of his brother and his 20-year quest to find answers.
It's hard to deal with any sort of loss, I guess. It's just the fact that, I guess, 9/11 has always been in the public eye. You know, references it all the time in films and papers and magazines and stuff, but it's, I mean, I'd say the passing of time has made it easier to some extent, but yeah, we still miss him.
Yeah, what was Geoff like?
Oh, he was a good looking, funny, intelligent, articulate. He was just a really good laugh. We had a lot of fun, only a year between us. He was just getting going in life. He just got engaged a few weeks before 9/11. And he had his whole life ahead of him.
Mm. And the cruelest thing is that he didn't actually work at the Twin Towers, did he? He was just there at a conference.
That's right. He normally worked up in Midtown. He worked for Reuters. And he was only there to attend the conference. Bit of networking, really. Shouldn't have really been there.
Gosh. What do you know about where he was when it happened?
Well, he was due to attend this conference, said, on the 106th floor of the North Tower. And we know, you know, he was running a bit late that morning. He sent me an email about 8:02 saying he was running late for the conference.
You mentioned his fiancée. They'd only got engaged, and it was 3 weeks prior. How is Caroline? I mean, how? It's hard to imagine how you ever get over something like that. You don't, I guess.
I think Caroline's found it really hard. She still lives in the flat that Geoff bought. That's obviously filled with memories and stuff.
And now as a family, you're asking the Attorney General to reopen the inquest. Why?
For me, the circumstances surrounding my brother's death, there's lots of things that don't sit right. It's fairly obvious. If you actually look at how the towers came down, and there's a great video by David Chandler called The North Tower Exploding, the tower is being demolished in front of your eyes. And a lot of people who reported on that day spoke in those ways. They thought it was bombs. They thought the towers had been destroyed.
So you think there were explosives in the buildings?
Yes. You know, the evidence that's there, this is, you've got explosives, residues in the dust. You've got numerous, I mean, I think it's over 150 eyewitnesses, first responders who are reporting explosions, bombs, etc., all of which was ignored. The reports that have been put forward to me, they were trying to fit it and frame it around a certain narrative. They never once investigated or looked into the fact that, you know, explosives could have been used.
It obviously sounds, Matt, like you've done extensive research over the past 20 years, but do you worry that some people will dismiss what you say and sort of just say, oh, we've heard all these conspiracy theories before?
Say that to the families of Bloody Sunday, say that to the families of Hillsborough. It's always the family members that dig the deepest and have to fight to get some sort of justice.
Matt Campbell there from Hurst Pier Point. Well, joining me now on the line is Ian Henshall from Hove. Ian runs Reinvestigate 9/11, a campaign group set up to challenge the official version of what happened. He's also the author of 9/11 Revealed and the 2007 follow-up 9/11 The New Evidence. Morning to you, Ian.
Morning, Alison. Thanks for having me on.
It was really interesting when I sat down with Matt Campbell and heard his story, because I think, you know, a lot of us have heard these conspiracy theories before. I'll be honest with you, we've had a text from somebody today saying, why, as a radio station, are you giving weight to these theories? It's difficult, isn't it? Because at the heart of this, you've got a family who've lost a loved one and they are seeking what they feel are unanswered questions.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think when, as soon as you hear somebody use the phrase conspiracy theory, you know, you sort of know where they're coming from. You know, they support the official line. And then in some cases, like your correspondent, they even try to have alternative views suppressed. And, of course, conspiracy theory is a very good phrase for suppressing alternative views. It can mean anything. Some conspiracy theories are crazy, some aren't. Of course, the worst conspiracy theories are the ones which are created by governments, and, you know, particularly the Nazi government in Germany. That was a government-backed conspiracy theory that Jews were to blame for all Germany's woes. So, you know, it's much more complicated. That's the thing that you really notice when you study 9/11, just how complicated it is and how enormous the evidence field is. There's a huge amount of paper trail evidence from FBI officers, which I can tell you about if we've got time. The head of counterterrorism, the head of terrorism in the White House at the time, has now spoken out, Richard Clark. He believes the hijackers were being protected by the CIA as part of a undercover operation, and that the 9/11 attacks, of course, wouldn't have happened if the terrorists had been arrested.
I mean, to think, though, there could have been a cover-up. I mean, it would have to have been on a mass scale. I suppose, you know, my thought is it feasible that you could have that many people keep a secret? Surely the truth would have come out by now, 20 years on.
Well, it sort of has, you know. I mean, for instance, the University of Alaska did a study on the collapse of the third building that collapsed on 9/11, because there were actually three big buildings that collapsed, not just two. His name's Leroy Halsey. You know, they've done a proper investigation, you know, with models, computer models, and they say that their models are better than the NIST models. But they've come to the very clear conclusion that the third building couldn't have been, based on their models, you know, which of course could be wrong. But to dismiss all this sort of thing as conspiracy theory, it's not just insulting to the families. It's also insulting to all the other victims of 9/11 in Afghanistan, because 9/11 triggered 20 years of war. You know, that's why I think it's still legitimate to talk about it now. And those wars aren't really abating. You know, they're leaving Afghanistan officially this autumn, but there's still going to be mercenaries and contractors there. Syria's still going on. You know, it's sort of... And in all over Central Africa, you've got these conflicts with al-Qaeda-type groups. So, you know, it's still all very relevant today.
The Campbell family are now calling for a new inquest into the death of Geoff. Do you think the Attorney General will rule in their favour?
Well, all you can say is that the Attorney General will be operating as a law officer and not as a politician. And I think, you know, we can just hope that we don't know what's going to be going on in their mind. But we can just hope that they will continue to, as they should, act as a lawyer and recognise that there is, you know, many reasons for doubting the original inquest verdict.
And when I spoke to Matt, he said that he does often get criticised for being some sort of crazy conspiracy theorist. I mean, obviously, you know, having written the books you have, the campaign group you run, do you come up against a lot of that as well?
It's more in the background, you know, like your caller who called in. You know, it's more about, I don't personally, I don't often appear in the mainstream media. talk radio, maybe, you know, that's about it. The others don't seem to want me. I mean, my first book was actually serialized in the Daily Mail. They gave it 3 pages, and nobody anywhere in the mainstream media took it up in the following week, which is, you know, as you'll know, as a media professional, that's really unusual. So, no, I don't get called a conspiracy theorist, and I wouldn't really care if I did, because it's such a meaning. It says more about the person using the phrase, really, than it does about anything else.
One of the things that someone has got in touch with me today and said is that they understand that this is a family who are grieving. And is this a case where, when people have lost a loved one, it is so hard to get your head around it, particularly when we're talking about events that were so horrific as 9/11 were, that actually it's quite a normal reaction to grief to try and find a different narrative?
Well, I mean, you know, everybody's different. You know, we all react differently to things. But I think usually there's an enormous pressure on people to accept the official narrative. They're in a state of shock, you know, tragedy. The last thing anybody wants to think is that they haven't been told the truth. So I think, you know, that's one reason why we haven't had more complaints from victims' families. But there is a huge lawsuit going on in America, directed at the Saudi government, and of course the Saudis deny the allegations. But there's a lot of family members who are very, very unhappy about the failure to investigate 9/11. And in fact, just recently Trump promised, you know, more fool his supporters, you know, but a lot of people believed his promises that he was going to open the books on 9/11. And it's yet another of the broken promises from the Trump administration, which have, you know, upset people.
It's fascinating. Thank you so much for joining us, Ian. Ian Henshall from Hove. Ian runs Reinvestigate 9/11, a campaign group set up to challenge the official version of what happened. As I say, he's also the author of a couple of books on the subject as well, 9/11 Revealed and 9/11 The New Evidence. Now, look, there obviously have been many questions raised about 9/11, but I do feel it's really important to stress that the official US government reports have categorically stated that it was fires that caused the World Trade Center to collapse and not controlled explosives, as the Campbell family believe. And as I say, if you want to get in touch and let me know where you were on that fateful day, please do. You can text me 81333. Start your message with the word radio. I wanna love that song, Gwen Stefani and The Sweet Escape. Got some great music still to come ahead of 10 o'clock this morning. Got some Gary Kemp on the way. But first, back to our top story. On today's show, we've been taking you back 20 years, yes, 20 years, to the 9/11 terror attacks in New York.
This just in, that is the World Trade Center. Apparently, a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center in New York.
Oh, my God.
Oh my God. That looks like a second plane.
That just exploded.
And we've been hearing how 20 years on, one Sussex family are still seeking answers.
You're never really going to get to know the entire truth about 9/11, but I do hope that this action through the inquest will start to open people's eyes that, you know, things aren't as simple as they've been explained to people.
That's Matt Campbell from Hearst Pier Point, whose brother Geoff died in the September 11th attacks on the World Trade Center. He perished in the North Tower, leaving behind a devastated fiancé in America and a grieving family in Sussex. But they've never accepted official accounts of the disaster, believing controlled explosives and not aircraft brought the building down.
The reports that have been put forward, they were trying to fit it and frame it around a certain narrative. They never once investigated or looked into the fact that, you know, explosives could have been used.
They want the Attorney General to order a new inquest and will begin legal action to do so very shortly. I really must stress, though, that this is their opinion, their views, and it does go against official versions of what took place. For instance, the American National Institute of Standards and Technology carried out a 3-year comprehensive building and fire safety investigation in 2002, issuing their findings in a final report published in October 2002. 2005. This is what their lead technical investigator, Shyam Sundar, said in that report.
The NIST team found no evidence that explosives were involved in the collapse.
And our analysis showed that even the smallest explosive charge that was capable of bringing down the critical column in the building, had it occurred, we would have seen sound levels of 120 to 130 decibels about a half a mile away. That would have been an incredibly loud sound, and that sound was not picked up by any of the videos or witnesses that we have talked to.
Well, I've been to Hurst Pier Point to speak to Matt Campbell, and he began our conversation by recalling that fateful day when he heard the news whilst on holiday in Lanzarote.
It's hard to deal with any sort of loss, I guess. It's just the fact that, I guess, 9/11 has always been in the public eye. You know, references it all the time in films and papers and magazines and stuff. But, it's, I mean, I'd say the passing of time has made it easier to some extent. But, yeah, we still miss him.
Yeah. What was Geoff like?
Oh, he was a good-looking, funny, intelligent, articulate. He was just a really good laugh. We had a lot of fun, really, a year between us. He was just getting going in life. He just got engaged a few weeks before 9/11, and he had his whole life ahead of him.
Mm. And the cruelest thing is that he didn't actually work at the Twin Towers, did he? He was just there at a conference.
That's right. He normally worked up in Midtown. He worked for Reuters, and he was only there to attend the conference. Bit of networking, really. Shouldn't have really been there.
Gosh. What do you know about where he was when it happened?
Well, he was due to attend this conference, said, on the 106th floor of the North Tower. And we know, you know, he was running a bit late that morning. He sent me an email about 2 minutes past eight saying he was running late for the conference.
You mentioned his fiancée. They'd only got engaged, and it was 3 weeks prior. How is Caroline? I mean, how? It's hard to imagine how you ever get over something like that. You don't, I guess.
I think Caroline's found it really hard. She still lives in the flat that Geoff bought. That's obviously filled with memories and stuff.
And now, as a family, you're asking the Attorney General to reopen the inquest. Why?
For me, the circumstances surrounding my brother's death, there's lots of things that don't sit right. It's fairly obvious. If you actually look at how the towers came down, and there's a great video by David Chandler called The North Tower Exploding. The tower is being demolished in front of your eyes, and a lot of people who reported on it that day spoke in those ways. They thought it was bombs, they thought the towers had been destroyed.
So you think there were explosives in the buildings?
Yes. You know, the evidence that's there, this is, you've got explosives, residues in the dust, you've got numerous, I mean, I think it's over 150 eyewitnesses, first responders who are reporting explosions, bombs, etc., all of which was ignored. The reports that have been put forward to me, they were trying to fit it and frame it around a certain narrative. They never once investigated or looked into the fact that, you know, explosives could have been used.
It obviously sounds, Matt, like you've done extensive research over the past 20 years, but do you worry that some people will dismiss what you say and sort of just say, oh, we've heard all these conspiracy theories before?
Say that to the families of Bloody Sunday, say that to the families of Hillsborough. It's always the family members that dig the deepest and have to fight to get some sort of justice.
Matt Campbell there from Hurst Pier Point, who tragically lost his brother Geoff in the 9/11 terror attacks. Now, it is important to point out that the official US government reports have categorically stated that it was fires that caused the World Trade Center to collapse and not controlled explosives, as the Campbell family believe.
BBC Radio Sussex.